Today I'm here to talk to you about the latest buzzword in our industry, microservices. So somehow, like I during the WSO2 conferences, I get the opportunity to talk about the buzzwords. So last year it was MBAS, mobile backend as a service. The year before it was IPaaS, integration platform as a service. So here I am this year to talk about microservices. So so let's talk about microservices and then see like what we have to offer in our new microservices server. I'll just talk about a few fundamentals about microservices architecture. So this is one of the definitions I got. Like, so typically in our industry, if you ask somebody what an ESB is, there are 10 definitions. Again, like for microservices architecture, there are multiple definitions. So these are like more or less they talk about the same concepts. So here, like this definition talks about a method of developing software applications as a suite of independently deployable small modular services. So the important words are highlighted here, and they communicate through well-defined lightweight mechanisms. So you can see there are a number of, you know, ambiguous words here. So how, when you say small, what do you mean by a small service? So somebody asked this question from Werner Vogels, Amazon CTO. So his answer was, you know, he tried to answer it, but then he gave up, and his strategy was okay. He asked the teams to build their services and make sure, you know, that they run it as, so that ensured that it's small enough so that, you know, when there are failures, they could independently deploy those bits. So so there's no hard and fast definition of what small is. So modular, so all these things are like fundamentals of computer science. So like what's the difference between SOA and microservices? Like somebody can argue saying, okay, this is the same thing. We've been seeing this for so many years. So so let's, like in the next few slides, we'll see what type of characteristics you have to look into when it comes to microservices. But then again, like most people like figure out, okay, for they have been doing microservices in their organizations for some time. So like communication through well-defined lightweight mechanisms, RESTful APIs. So these are not things that are new, but there are certain aspects that you have to think about in order to have a microservices solution which you know, which satisfies these characteristics. So this is from the popular article from Martin Fowler's website or his blog. So basically, the idea is you have your monolithic application, and if you want to scale up your application, you have to scale up the entire runtime. So like you can, as you can see in this part, this is your monolithic application. If you want to scale it up, you have to scale up all the bits. So this, the application contains multiple components which are communicating through standard, maybe like software APIs, you know, programming APIs, Java APIs, stuff like that. So when you have to scale it up, you have to, you know, scale up the entire system. So one of the problems you might have in such a system is there could be bits that you are unnecessarily scaling up. So you might have software that you have to pay by the number of instances you are running. So, so if you run additional instances, you have to pay for those bits even though you don't actually need them. So what if we can break this big application into its components, and then like if we can deploy them independently and scale them independently? So that's basically the idea behind this discussion. And then like when it comes to scaling an application, there is this concept of a scale cube. So you have, they're talking about x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis scaling. So with x-axis scaling is the traditional horizontal scaling where you scale up your entire application. Z-axis scaling talks about partitioning of data. Right, so you scale up your system, which is similar to horizontal scaling, but then again, a subset of your cluster would be handling a subset of your data, rather than all nodes in your system handling the entire data set. So you partition your data set. So y-axis scaling is basically you break up you decompose your solution into multiple components, and then you scale up and down the relevant components as and when necessary. And then there is this interesting article published by Gartner, which talks about the inner and outer architectures of a microservices solution. So, as you know, right, none of these things are silver bullets in our industry. So the problems don't go away. You basically move it to an outer layer, or you abstract it out. So still, when it comes to a microservices solution, you have the same problems of a distributed system. But someone could argue that even these problems are magnified in a microservices deployment. So the inner architecture is basically the architecture within the services themselves. So and then there is the more important aspect, which is the outer architecture, where you have to think about the deployment of this microservices management, auto scaling, auto healing, and exposing these things as API. So one of the I actually did a tutorial session on Monday related to microservices as well. So one of the questions that somebody asked me is where does an API gateway fit in to this solution? So like an API gateway or an ESB. So generally that sort of thing would be fitting in within your outer architecture. So you would still have your managed APIs which you expose to your outside world for integration to your to integrate with mobile clients, for B2B integration and so on. So you would still have all those bits within the outer architecture. So basically your outer architecture is very similar to an application PaaS. So you have to handle scaling, failover, monitoring, auto healing, all those aspects live within the outer architecture. So the outer architecture is the more complicated thing in a microservices solution. And then, again from Martin Fowler's blog, so polyglot persistence is one of the characteristics or a benefit that you could have in a microservices solution. So you could build your solution using different technologies, different data storage mechanisms, and so on. And like the main idea is your microservices are modular, and they can self-sustain themselves with their own data. So typically you wouldn't be sharing your data or your schemas with other microservices. So that's what enables these microservices to be able to independently develop and then to independently evolve their schemas and so on. So the contract is again like SOA. You have your APIs published, and the consumers will be just relying on your APIs. There is no coupling at the data level. So you could be using different technologies. So you could be using RDBMS with one microservice. With a different microservice, you might be using a Redis database or something like that. Your microservices could be developed in Java, PHP, whatever. So one of the good places for you guys to, if you are new to microservices, to get started with the WSO2 MSS or the microservices server is to take a look at the pet store sample that we've included with our release. So there we have actually included a number of technologies. So I have a slide on that. When I come to that, I'll talk about it. So the vision for WSO2 microservices server. As you know, in a microservices solution, typically you would be running it with some sort of container mechanism, like Docker and a container choreography or orchestration mechanism like Kubernetes. You should be able to spawn up as many containers as possible within very short periods of time, and then the interactions should be very fast. So the other thing is like Docker containers. If you worked with Docker, you know it, within a few seconds you could launch a Docker container. But then again, if you're going to run a very heavyweight process which takes a few minutes to boot up, that's basically going to actually defeat the purpose, because like as and when you need your containers, you should be able to spawn up containers, and within seconds those should be available. So to achieve that, the runtimes should be lightweight, and you have to pay attention to the memory consumption. So these are important aspects, and then like to improve you've actually taken your monolithic application and you've separated it into multiple components which are now communicating over a network interface, right? So one of the things that you have to think about is these calls, or the latency and the throughput of these services should be very efficient. So that's one of the key design goals of the microservices server. We need a model for developers. So like how do you develop microservices? So we've included a Java annotation based mechanism. So we'll take a look at some samples. I will go through those samples and you'll be able to see how we use that. We do support well-known JAX-RS annotation. So the most intuitive way for expose a Java RESTful API is the JAX-RS annotations. But we've not relied on any JAX-RS implementation like Jersey and so on. It's not just bound to JAX-RS. So we have our own annotations like the metric annotations and so on. So we've written our lightweight and fast JAX-RS annotations framework, which supports the widely used JAX-RS annotations. Simple ways to develop and deploy microservices, analytics platforms. That's something that's important, because you want to see how your services are performing. You need analytics dashboard. So like Sanjeeva presented the vision for the company, all of our products will come with analytics inbuilt. So that's something that we've taken into consideration in MSS as well. As a solution architect or a solution developer, just using microservices server is not going to solve all the problems. So you have to actually design your solution with the microservices architecture in mind. But what we could do as a middleware vendor is basically provide you the relevant tools and the best practices for you to be able to achieve that. One of the things that we've been thinking about is making it possible to deploy WSO2 products in a microservices manner as well. For example, you know that the WSO2 products include the user management components, the registry components. So if you want to just scale out those components, you should be able to deploy them separately and scale them out as and when necessary. So that's something that we are thinking about. The implementation, we just released the 1.0 alpha last Friday. It's based on the new Carbon 5 kernel. Samira spoke about this in the first session. So the Carbon 5 kernel is a complete rewrite of the previous kernel. One of the design goals is keep it small, keep it simple, keep it lightweight. And the transport is based on Netty. So very efficient and high throughput, low latency scenarios, Netty is a very good framework to be used, and then support streaming. So if you have a microservice you know, which is handling file uploads and downloads. You know, you should have streaming, so you can, we have APIs which allow you to stream your requests directly up to your microservice, and then you could basically take care of that request. For example, if there is a file upload, you would keep receiving HTTP chunks. So as and when you receive chunks, you could open a file channel out. Let's say you're saving this file, you could simply create a channel and keep on saving those chunks into the file, writing those chunks into the file, rather than loading loading everything into memory, and when once the file upload is completed, storing it. So we've provided the API so that it's directly streamed up to your microservice itself. So we've done some performance comparisons with other frameworks as well. I'll present those slides. So the distribution size, 5 MB. Right, so that's important when you create containers to keep the distribution size down. So 5 MB pack size starts within 300 milliseconds as opposed to a few seconds traditional servers take. And then low memory footprint. So these are some of the data from our profiling. So the download is available on GitHub. So if you go to the releases page, so so under the WSO2 account, we have products MSS. So if you go to releases, you can basically download the release. So a good place to get started is the samples, right? So once you download it, take a look at the samples. I'll provide a guide on how to follow through the samples. So the core features, quick and simple development model using annotations, lightweight, high performance, custom interceptors. So again, you could develop your microservice, and then you might figure out, okay, I need to do some common things. I need to log all the requests that are coming in, or I need to implement a security layer in front of all my microservices. So that can be implemented as a interceptor. We do have, so microservices now interact with each other. So how do we authenticate and authorize these interactions? How do we know that this is a valid call that is coming in? So we have support for JWT, JWT-based security. So at the moment, we do signature verification as well as token expiry checking. So claims support is coming. Gathering metrics and publishing them, tracing of request IDs, because a request that's coming into your microservice might actually flow through to other microservices. So you should be able to trace your requests, streaming input and output support, tooling based on Developer Studio. So you can start by defining your microservice API as a Swagger API definition, and then generate the skeleton code. It will generate the project for you. And then you could start building your microservice. And then we have a set of samples. So the thread model, so we have Netty. Netty would basically receive the requests, and then it goes through a set of Netty interceptors or handlers. So you have the HTTP codex and so on. And then what happens is these are I/O threads. So once it reaches the WSO2 Netty interceptor, what happens is these threads are immediately released, and the rest of the flow is handled by a different event executor thread pool, so that we don't block up these threads. So the event executor thread pool will then take care of routing your requests to the relevant service. So within a single runtime, you could have multiple services, but typically you may not have many services within a single runtime, because that might, that might go against your design principles. But the architecture still allows you to have a few services within the same runtime. So that's a design choice. So that's basically the thread model. So the incoming requests, if you define the APIs to handle streaming, we would be streaming it directly from Netty to your service. Some performance figures. So this is some ongoing work. We've compared MSS. So this is one of our design goals. So we have to constantly keep on looking at the performance figures. So we've compared it with some of the frameworks out there. So MSS is right at the top. So we have Drop Wizard, Spring Boot, Spark Java. So these are some of the figures that throughput figures that we are seeing. For some reason, Drop Wizard at a concurrency of 1,200, it started giving errors. So we need to look into that further. So things are looking good. So Spark is a very small library. It's just a few kilobytes. So you could say it's lightweight. But then again, the transport is based on Jetty. So that might be the reason why it's not performing as well as the other frameworks out there. And we also compared the memory consumption. So as you can see, Spark has the best figures when it comes to the memory consumption. MSS is about around the middle. So developer experience and programming model. So if you want to develop your microservices in Java, we provide you the APIs, and we provide you the tooling to do that. So now we are looking at a Hello World service. So we have a pom.xml file. So it's a Maven project archetype. So the parent has to be set as the microservices server parent. So this basically simplifies your pom, because all the core dependencies will now be inherited from the parent. And then, of course, you could define your artifact ID, group ID, and so on. And we have two modes of deploying a microservice. So one is all-in-one Uber jar, right? You have a single jar file, which is created when you run your build. And that will basically contain all the dependencies. And you could simply say Java minus jar and execute that. So that's very handy when it comes to Docker, because you just have to give that as your entry point. The other approach is you create it as a jar file, and you drop it into the WSO2 microservices server deployment directory. So it's similar to dropping a web app into Tomcat web apps directory. So here, this approach is basically showing you how to do it as an Uber jar. So you need to provide your main class. So the main class name is application. So this is the Maven property that we are using there. So it's a very simple Maven pom.xml file. So this is your this is a stock code service. So you can see we are using annotations. So we are using the path annotation over there. And this is one of the resource methods. So get code. So if you get a stock code slash requesting stock code slash symbol, the symbol could be one of these, IBM, Google, IBM, Google, or Amazon. It will simply provide you the response. So the response can be JSON, XML, text plain, text XML. So we support those types. So you basically have to specify what type of payload you could consume and what type of response you can send. So that's a simple class. And then once you have written your stock code service, you just have to write a class with the main method, and then instantiate a runner called deploy. So you can deploy one or many microservices, and then you just call start. So when you say call start, basically it's at that point the netty ports are open. So you keep on deploying, and then eventually once the deployments are complete, you would open your ports. So build it, MVN clean install, run it, Java minus jar, and you just give the jar file name. So it's very simple. So tooling, you can start with your Swagger definition, and then use the Eclipse tooling. So if you download this, the instructions are there in the pack. on how to install this. You download it and then you create your project, and it would create the relevant skeleton classes as well as the project structure with the relevant annotations and your resource methods and so on. So streaming support, this is from a streaming example. So the important thing is, so this is the resource method, aggregate, no sorry, stream. So what you have to do is you have to register a callback, and what happens is whenever there is a chunk available in your callback, the chunk method will get called. And when you receive the final chunk, basically we would call finished. So what you could do is you could open a file channel when you receive the first chunk, you keep on writing to that file channel, and when it's finished, you simply flush that file channel and close it. And on errors, you will get notified. The onError method would, the error method would get notified. So analytics and metrics. So we currently support four types of annotations: timed, measured, counted, and metered. So like we are measuring different aspects. So these are some aspects. So you could read through the documentation. So different aspects related to your runtime execution. So you can see, so these are the annotations in the sample. So you just have to, along with your Java method annotations or your resource annotations, you have to simply put the analytics annotations, and it would take care of doing the analytics for you. So as you can see, I talked about adding interceptors. So in order to enable that, so your sample basically becomes a bit more complicated. Earlier we were just deploying the service and then starting it. Now you have to add the analytics interceptor. So the analytics interceptor will simply enable capturing of analytics. So this doesn't generally add a lot of overhead, because the publishing and capturing and publishing is done asynchronously. And then there are like different modes. So you could publish your analytics to the console, which is the simplest mode. You could publish it to JMX, or you could publish it to WSO2 Data Analytics Server, DAS. So this is the output from the console. The console output from the analytics component. So when you enable this and run your sample, you will be able to see periodically these analytics getting printed onto the console. And then this is the JMX based one, and the DAS based tooling. So this is we have included instructions on how to enable this dashboard as well. So if you download the WSO2 MSS pack, we have instructions. So you have to download the data analytics server as well, and then basically set up a MySQL DB. So that's where the data will get summarized. And you know, you could see the analytics of your particular service. So you can see, so these are the microservices that are running within the system. So you could basically click on those and drill down to service level stats. So security, like I said, it's done using JWT. So the way to do that is you add an interceptor. So the interceptor architecture allows you to even like plug in your own, if you want to do SAML, you could simply write your SAML interceptor and plug it in there. So runtime options, Java minus jar, drop services jar, or you could use Kubernetes and Docker. So deployment options, so we've been talking about Docker and Kubernetes a lot, so I will not go into the details. So so this is the Docker file for the stock code service that we saw earlier. So the important thing is, now, so we are using a Java 8, OpenJDK 8 JRE. And you can see the entry point is the command that we use to run on the command line, Java minus jar, stock code service jar, right? So that's the Docker file. And then this is already there in the sample. So if you go to the stock code sample, these files are there. So we create a Kubernetes replication controller. So when we create the Docker image, we give the image name as WSO2 MSS or whatever. So these are the name that you specify when you created the image. And then we are defining this as a Kubernetes service, which is a load balanced endpoint. So this is a proxy endpoint which will basically take care of routing the request to your relevant microservice. So you could tell the replication controller to create as many replicas as you want. You could scale up and down using the Kubernetes commands. And then the stock code service will basically take care of routing the request to the relevant instance. So the Kubernetes UI, if you haven't seen it before, it's very handy. So the system, in this particular test system, we are running with two nodes. So you can see the CPU memory file system allocation, that type of stats. And like you could even like look at what services are running in your system, what are the pods that are deployed. So all that information can be seen. The pet store sample is a comprehensive sample that we basically developed to showcase how to develop or to create a microservices solution. That basically uses PHP on the front end, and then we have microservices server backends for handling addition of pets, transactions, and stuff like that. And then there is a security microservice which basically handles security. So these are the relevant microservices interactions, the service calls. So we have two front ends for the administration and the store. For authentication, we have security. And once you authenticate, the security service will issue or JWT token. Subsequent calls to the other microservices will include the JWT token. We have two microservices, pet and transaction. And we are using a Redis database for persistence. And all of these services publish their metrics to DAS. So that's the pet store sample. So you could go through that. So the deployment view basically looks like this. We are running on two Kubernetes nodes. So Kubernetes will basically take care of creating the pods in the relevant nodes, depending on various factors. As you can see now, this is just a snapshot. There's more load coming into the store front end, because that's where people will be logging in to view the store. So you can see there are three instances of this particular store service running. In the case of admin, one instance is sufficient. So if that instance fails, the Kubernetes health monitoring system, it will basically take care of spawning a new instance. And then like the security service, again, might have to scale up separately, because most of the login calls would increase the load on the security service. The file server basically stores the images. So that is another service that might be under heavy load. So you have more instances of that. Again, like transactions, you might have more instances. And then the Redis system. So this is basically like a deployment view of that sample. So at the top layer, we have the relevant services at the Kubernetes level. So the store service, admin service, security service, transaction, and so on. So I haven't included the lines or the connections to all the pods, because that would clutter the diagram. One of the questions that people might have is if you know that WSO2 pricing is based on the number of instances. So when it comes to microservices deployments, that doesn't work, because for container-based deployments, you would scale up and scale down, a fixed figure. For a traditional deployment, yes, you do a capacity planning. You decide on the number of instances, and then pretty much your deployment is static. But for container-based deployments, we are actually figuring out a formula, and that would be announced pretty soon. One of the things that I have to emphasize is Kubernetes and Docker are not mandatory requirements to run MSS. It's one of the ways in which we are demonstrating how our samples can run. But you could decide to run it on Cloud Foundry or whatever the frameworks that you are using, because at the code level we have no coupling to any of these underlying container frameworks. So the code is available there. So the NetE transport. So this is the NetE transport, which is used by the WSO2 gateway as well. So we are sharing the same components. So the WSO2 gateway is a high-performance gateway. So we are automatically inheriting all the performance benefits of that particular transport because they're sharing the component and the code is available there. So to recap, we discussed a bit about the microservices architecture and looked at the development and programming model, deployment model, tooling, and comparison of microservices server with some other frameworks out there. Thank you.